It's June of 1998, and I'm done with York University. To celebrate, my friends and I embarked on a camping trip to the Pinery Provincial Park, just down the road from Grand Bend. It was just outside the liquor store in town that I heard a finished version of Poets for the first time. Gord had long been one of my favorite poets, so to me this song resonated in a way that I can't quite describe. It was a feeling of euphoria and relief. This new record was going to be just fine, I thought to myself. Little did I know that several tracks on this record would stand the test of time and join the pantheon of great hip songs I still enjoy to this day. From the meandering Escape Is at Hand to The Traveling Man, to the exquisite Bob Cajun, and the downright delicious Emperor Penguin, Phantom Power was right in the pocket coming off of the exceptional Trouble at the Henhouse. As I got inside the truck to head back to the campsite, I turned the volume up and just let Poets sink into my brain. This was living. Today, we're going to hear from our friends Pete and Tim to check out what they think of Phantom Power. Will it stack up? Find out today on Getting Hip to the Hip.
Long Slice Brewery presents Getting Hip to the Hip.
Hey, it's JD here. Welcome back to Getting Hip to the Hip. This week, we are talking about Phantom Power, the sixth studio record by seminal Canadian rock band, The Tragically Hip. I'm joined this week, as always, by my pals, Tim and Pete. Fellas, how are you doing?
Hey, guys. Glad to be here. Good to see you.
I'm ecstatic to be here. To be here right now.
Oh, I love it. I love the energy. This is
happier
good.
Than a pig in shit.
Oh, boy. That's pretty happy. I've seen some porcine creatures rolling in fecal matter, and they sure love it. Okay, so if you are wanting to experience the Tragically Hip music for the first time, Tim and Pete are your avatars this week because they got to experience the record Phantom Power, which again is the sixth record produced by Steve Berlin. First record on Universal, but I guess I should tell you guys both. I guess I should say this to you both as honorary Canadians now. Happy Canada Day. It's almost the 4th of July. It's July 3rd today, but it's July 4th tomorrow for you, but July 1st for us is Canada Day. So happy Canada Day, folks.
Wow.
Yeah.
Very close to the other 4th of July, which is America's Independence Day. And that's in right. The UK, they call that Thanksgiving.
No.
No, but that, like, no, dude, I took a flight one time on some shitty airline, and the pilot was British, and it was on the 4th of July, and he was like, so I just want to say, you know, that's my shitty British accent, you know, happy 4th of July, or as we call it where I'm from, Thanksgiving. Enjoy your
whatever.
Motherfucker.
That's great. Oh, anytime you can burn an American a little bit, it's right. You know, there's some fun. There's some fun there. Because you guys are so goddamn good at shit, you know?
Yeah. What anyway, can we say, right, Tim?
let's get into the record as a whole before we go into the song-by-song segment. Let's just talk about this record. Produced, like I said, by Steve Berlin. Five singles come from this record. All Music rates it a 3 out of 5.
3.
So there's that. What did you guys think? I want to know where you listened to it, how you listened to it, and what your initial thoughts were, and you know maybe what they percolated up to. What do you say there, Tim?
Well, oof, there's a pause. I thought it was a 3-star album, kind of like All Music. I felt, wasn't really sure. It felt a little bit diluted in a way to me. It felt a little bit A little bit more generic from what I've heard in the past. But it also felt kind of expected. I mean, for the whole catalog of albums this band has produced and the timeline going into the late 90s, you know, this album felt like full of radio hits, but at the same time, I was missing a little bit of that raw kind of hip feeling. You know, I was wondering, like, should I be okay with this album just being kind of fine? It was the turning point for me. I was really not sure. When I read kind of some reviews about it, I think there was some shared sentiment. And also some people were like, it's my favorite album. And some hip fans said it's their least favorite album. So this one's kind of a gray area for me.
It's funny. I'll get into my, you know, sort of backgrounder on this for you guys after we hear from Pete. Pete, what did you think?
I hear you on the gray area because I could totally see that. I could totally see how some hip fans are like, this is the best album they did, or this is not my favorite album. For me, I listen to it everywhere. I listen to it in my office, so from my computer with some decent cans. I took it out running a lot. Probably, I think maybe the first time I listened to it was that. Took it in the car. It sounded great. The thing I found, I would say 3.5 for me, Tim, instead of a 3, but, you know, I feel you on that. My initial thoughts were that a lot of rawness of the hip was gone from this. Mm-hmm. First couple listens, it sounded very watered down. It was like somebody pulled Gord Downie aside and said, hey, man, can we just, like, kind of like the dude, can you take it easy, man? You yeah. know, just like told him yeah. to just like chill out a little bit. And I don't know. I the more I listened to it, though, and the more I dug into it and see how much work, maybe not production, but just from the band themselves went into this record, maybe changed my tune a lot. Like, I dig it. And Phantom Power, that was the coolest thing in the 90s, man. Like, because sometimes you didn't know what it was if you never heard of Phantom Power before. It has a fucking cool name. If you had a guy that had a condenser mic or something with Phantom Power, you're like, dude, yeah, he's got a mic that's got it's got Phantom Power. It was just like fucking, you were 17 and you heard that. It was fucking cool.
Yeah.
You know, I went and looked at number of albums sold by a bunch of different bands, including The Hip. And I was trying to kind of find this correlation of how many albums sold from the band's start to like 10 years later, or 10 albums later, something like that. And I compared The Hip with a bunch of bands, and it's really all apples to oranges, of course. But when you look at how many albums they've sold, and how they, you know, started off selling a ton and then just kind of went down to this million album mark. And then when I heard this album, and I, like you, Pete, I listened to it all over the place. I listened to it on the plane. I traveled, listened to it in the car, listened to it at home with the cans on. I mean, I listened to it in more places than past listens because I was really trying to give it a go. I mean, it was the first time upon first listen that there were a couple songs where I was like, okay, get it. I'm going to go to the next one. Like, I had not fast forwarded songs yet or skipped ahead. So this, oh. Yeah, but one of those songs that I skipped ahead on, sorry, hip fans, you know, I came back to, and it might be one of my most favorite on the album. So this one to me, like, didn't grab me right away. Maybe it will more over time. Maybe it's one of those types of albums, but.
Well, I'll tell you what, this record has an interesting story, I think. And it's my own headcanon. This is not like actual fact by any stretch, but in my opinion, Trouble at the Hen House, which is one of my absolute favorite records, by the Tragically Hip or any other band, was maligned
Like both it and Day for Night didn't perform as well as Fully Completely. And Fully Completely was very, if you recall, it was very polished. It was very produced. You know, they went to London to record it. It was like a big deal. And then following that, the next two records, they were sort of self-produced with Mark Vreeken and Mark Howard on Day for Night, and just Vreeken on Fully on Trouble at the Hen House. And those records are sparse, and they are the core energy is there. It's like boiling hot magma, you know, and they're forming these songs that are just age old now and just wonderful. And then Phantom Power comes out, and Phantom Power goes back to the, like, to me, it's sort of back to the basics. It's like back to really structured songs, really produced. And like I always said that this record was the baby of Day for Night and Fully and Completely. Fully Completely, rather, not Fully and Completely. Fully Completely. It's sort of the baby of those two records. It's got the production values, but it's still got songs. So I'll challenge you guys on that, because I think this record has songs. And you, I think it has songs for days.
You know what you are, JD? Let me tell you who you are. So when I was like 19 or 18 working at the movie theater, I dated this girl that that worked at the calendar place across the way. And I just kind of went out with her because I was like really stoked she gave me her number. But I really wasn't that into her. And all my friends were like, dude, she's really hot, man. She's really amazing. And I just didn't see it. And so then like I stopped going out with her. We only went out a couple times, and that was that. And then I saw her again. I was like, damn, I really screwed that one up. And that's kind of how I felt with this record, but I didn't want to like make that same mistake again. So like I'm sticking with it. I'm sticking with this being a solid album.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
Asking it for a third and fourth date.
Yeah. I think 3 out of 5 stars is fair. Like it's not my favorite record, but it's a lot of Hip Fans' favorite record. It's a lot.
Yeah. That's what I found in my research.
The cover's awesome.
The cover's great. Actually have that panel in their studio in Bath.
Wow.
Which is really cool. Yeah. So that's, you know, this is the second record they recorded at their studio. Bath. So they didn't go anywhere, you know, adventurous or anything like that, but they were at home. And what happened in 1998, I don't know if it made news anywhere else, but Quebec and Ontario, there was a major ice storm. In Ontario, it absolutely shut down the city of Toronto. It shut down, you know, major thoroughfares. It was like devastating, this ice storm. And we'll get into that a little bit more as we talk about the songs. But, you know, they bring Berlin in, and they're sort of trapped in the studio, you know, like during this. So really fascinating, I think. Go ahead.
Did you see this tour? Did you see them play on this tour?
You want to hear a story? Now, yeah, people who listen to Berlin completely heard this. But the Hip announced 5 secret shows that they were going to do. And all proceeds from these shows were going to go to a charity. I forget which charity now. It was Camp Trillium. Camp Trillium, which is a camp for children with cancer. Children that have cancer. And there's a location of that is near where I grew up. And I'll show you when you're in town for the finale. My friend's parents were on the committee for the cancer camp in our community. And so my friend Heather had intel, and she knew that they were going to go on sale at this time and this place in Hamilton, which is about an hour outside of Toronto when traffic's good. And so we ended up getting third row center seats.
Wow.
In this small theater in Hamilton, like 2,000 people. And they blew the roof off the place. A band and a band called oh my goodness, they sang Come for a Ride opened for them, and they were tremendous as well. I forget the band right now who opened for them. But if you know it, send me an email, jd@gettinghiptothehip.com. So we're third row center. We watched the show, but the kicker here is that Heather has got gifts to give the band, and it's been arranged with the stage manager that we're going to go backstage afterwards to give. She's going to go backstage afterwards to give these gifts. Nice. And she ended up inviting me along. And so we got to go backstage, and I introduced her to the Tragically Hip. So this was like full circle for the two of us. And it was just a wonderful experience. We went backstage after the show, and they were all there. And Gord Downie had a soccer ball. And he was doing that thing where you flip it out, catch it, and roll it back in your arms. Flip it out, catch it, roll it back in your arms. And he just kept doing that. And I remember at one point, I must have looked silly or something, because somebody said, and maybe it was Gord Downie, said, "Is everything all right?" And I said, "Oh, everything is fucking perfect. I could go outside and get hit by a bus right now, and it just wouldn't matter." And Gord Downie looked at me and he goes, "Aw, don't do that, James." He called me James. Only my mom calls me James. Like, it Precious. Was so cool. It was.
How did I not know this story? How did I not know that you had interactions with Jesus Christ?
Yeah.
How is this coming up in episode? What fucking episode are we on?
Well, it was Tim asked me the question. Yeah.
I don't know. We're like 15 minutes in. I think we could just call it. That was good enough. Yeah. That was great.
Well, here's the kicker. I don't think I told this part on fully and completely, but the kicker is I had been dating a girl all through university, and I broke up with her the summer of 98 and sowed my wild oats. And this was all toward the end of the summer of 98. And she was in Hamilton to meet me after the show. So I'm backstage with the Hip, and they go, "Okay, well, we're going to go to the after party now in the next room over," because this was in the green room or whatever. And we're going to go in the after party room and drink some beers. Do you guys want to join us? And I had to say no. I had to say no because my girlfriend was waiting outside for me. Yeah. Now, in hindsight, what a boner move I made. Because I wanted to get back together with her.
Totally. But
it only lasted another 2 years after that. Like, and then it absolutely blew up. But it was those final 2 years were awful anyway. Like they just weren't, you know, like both of us would agree to that now, I'm sure. The university years were wonderful. They were great. But those 2 years after our breakup were not so good. And I blew a chance to go party with the Hip.
You had a Davis Manning moment.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah, absolutely.
You chose the girl over your fandom.
The Hip lived between us.
They totally live between you. They it's might still. East, they the might still. Sorry, Jess.
Yeah. Well, folks, should we go song by song?
Yeah, let's do it.
Let's do it. So, I really liked this song. I really liked Poets. This is probably the song I would say I have the least to say about. I really like the verse phrasing. I think it's probably the best part of this song, the way he phrases the verses. There's a part where the lines of a verse, he kind of like carries into the next measure. It's really weird. Like the mind, you think, okay, you sing the verse, then it's the next measure. But like he sings that verse over the next, because it's when you look at it, it's a complete line. Can't remember the line specifically, but it was cool, man. It's a hard thing to pull off, man. But like that guy just does it with so much finesse. I liked the layered guitars in it. But I think, going back to what we were saying sort of at the beginning, at the top of the show, this song didn't punch me in the face. Like right when I started listening, I dug it. It was a soft open.
All right. How'd you feel, Tim?
I felt it was a harder open. I thought it was, it, you know, this, it, like we've talked about before, the cadence of songs and track orders, you know, the first one I expect to really get me, bring me in, and this one did it. I thought it was pretty good. There's a fun kind of changeover into the chorus. It, again, I spoke about this a little bit before, but they kind of reminded me of REM and REM's like first half of the 90s albums. Like they come on with like a punch of a song and then like the cadence of the album kind of goes soft and then gets, whoa, got a little dirty there. It gets a little bit harder as time evolves. But yeah, this, I thought this was a good start off the themes. You know, I looked into a little bit of the song's meaning regarding lyrics, and you know, there's talk about agriculture and super farms and like, I don't know, ultimately fresh vegetables versus buying frozen and what that means. And this is the song that references Gwen Jacobs, right? Do you know the story about her, JD? No. And she was this woman who walked into town, I think in Ontario, topless, and it created this whole, I'm gonna have to look into this more, but I'm pretty sure this was a song about the Gwen Jacobs case. So Gwen was a woman who walked through town topless and was arrested and started this whole kind of woman's lib, you know, movement with, you know, making it okay to cut your lawn without a shirt on, just like the men do. That's kind of where the line in here from,
right,
Gord, where Gord comes from. It's
oh, that's great. Lawn cut by bare-breasted women.
Yeah, it's kind of this comment on pushing for women's equality and gender rights. So I thought that was fucking cool, and that to me also is like really appropriate for the 90s or late 90s. You know, it was, we were kind of circling back to, of course, some themes we've had in North America before and prior decades. So I thought this song was cool. Again, it really reminded me of REM. I kind of went back and started looking at some of REM's albums. And I wish I could know what the band listened to when they were traveling.
Me too.
You know, what they were sharing, what albums they were digging. You know, if any of them were like, oh my God, did you hear REM's new one? We're going to put it in the bus's stereo or whatever. Like, I wish I could know what was influencing them, because I'm hearing some themes for sure.
Okay, earlier I was telling you about the ice storm. The next track, Something On, was recorded and they literally were trapped in the studio. They were, you know, they couldn't leave the bathhouse. They couldn't leave the studio in Bath. So they did what they do best. They wrote a song, and there's some lyrical content in there about the ice storm even. And I think it's really wonderful lyricism. What did you guys think of Something On?
I felt like, okay, I read about it. I read about this and I read about the ice storm, and you know, sounded awful. And for, I hate to say this, but to go get stuck in a studio for me, that'd be like the time to really fuck things up, like really experiment, you know, just hopefully somebody shows up with a huge bag of weed and somebody shows up with a bunch of acid and somebody shows up with a shit ton of beer. And like, this is when you like really go to town to experiment. And what do we get out of it? We got kind of a radio hit. So I was a little surprised to kind of hear the whole story. And it just made me realize that maybe for this era, the guys were really, I mean, they were at a point to where they could bust out a really good album, you know. And what, for me, that really good album is like, you go to a restaurant and it's like, yeah, that was a good meal. You know, everything was like satisfactory.
Well, again,
it's a blooming onion, man. It's a blooming onion.
Yeah, but to get stuck in a studio in an ice storm, it's like, I personally would want to just start going places I haven't been before with my band. But you know, this one felt,
that's an interesting take.
Yeah, this one felt so. This one felt a little radio. It felt a little U2, Dave Matthews, like splash of John Cougar Mellencamp or something. Like, oh, I don't know, boy. Man. I know. But that.
And I was a big Mellencamp guy at one point. But Dave Matthews.
Cougar or regular?
Cougar. And regular.
Okay. Yeah. Good answer. Okay. Yeah. Like I couldn't get overly excited about this one.
Well, again, I think you were waiting for the follow-up to Trouble at the Hen House. And this isn't the follow-up that you're expecting on a trajectory perspective. You know?
Pete? No, I agree. It's funny you talk about getting trapped in the studio. Like, I mean, I don't know if I'd go like full Steely Dan when they recorded the album Gaucho, where like, you know, there maybe was not that much cocaine around, but I still agree with Tim. I'd get really spacey. And I think they do it on a couple songs that we'll get into. But first time I heard the song, got some heavy Jim Blossoms feels.
Yeah. Oh, wow.
That's the first thing that hit me. I couldn't think of the name of the band, and it was like a buddy of mine used to play the band that they opened for them a ton. And I was like the first band that came to mind. I liked this. Oof. And it was really poppy. My notes. Once you get past the repeated cheesiness of the chord progression and the vocal melody, it's not a bad song.
Oh, damning with faint praise here.
No. It's not a bad song. I think it's a good song. But, you know, it's a good song. If, like, you take this song and go, is this a good song? Anybody will say, it's a good song. But like it's you said, PD, compared to the follow-up of what you really wanted after Trouble Then House, and this was a song where I feel like Gord sounded a bit like he was put in the cage. Like, whoever was at Universal when this record was getting recorded put Baby in the corner. And this is a song where it really... I feel like, you know, he wants to be himself, but somebody's like, hey man, just could you like, you don't have to do it on all the songs, but like, at least on this one, could you just fucking, you know, tone it down a little bit? And I was just like, ah, where's my lead singer?
Yeah, I totally agree. Because, you know, it's still a good song because it's still all the guys and it still has themes because it's Gord. You know, you're still going to get one-liners that are amazing, I feel like, probably no matter what, in any hip song. There's going to be some standout lyric. It's going to be some standout part, like, to the core fan. That's really what I'm imagining. The line that stood out in this one for me was, your imagination's having puppies. I mean...
Yeah.
I've had so many litters of puppies, you guys. It's like, I've got puppies all over the place. It's like,
that was a cool line. I really like that line.
Yeah. Like that
video for new recruits or something.
Yeah. So I like identified in it, you know, at that personal level, which I think they're able to do just about on any song, which is fucking amazing for a band to do, because I could probably name 10 bands right now where that does not happen to me.
Yeah.
So, you know, so in that regard, like hip fans, you know, I'm not really trying not to be the bad guy here, but this song just made me keep going. So into Save the Planet. I mean, I got to this one, arrived at this one, and I was like, is this the band's fucking Earth Day song or their reach to get on the Farm Aid bill? Like, what is going on here? I felt like, I don't know. There's a flute in there. Who's playing the flute? Who plays the flute?
You know, I don't have the liner notes handy. And on the wiki page, it is remarkably barren in terms of additional players.
Yeah.
It doesn't have them. So
we need people to write in. If people know, let us know. Because there's some flute in there. And it made me wonder, like, what else...
There's keys all over this record.
Yeah. What else have I been missing in the background that maybe other people are participating in? But I felt like, you know, this song in the placement, we were filling in the gaps on the menu, and you were like, no, I had a burger yesterday. No, I'm not in the mood for that. Oh, I could really use some lasagna. Here we go. That's how Save the Planet felt. felt very time appropriate. This is like, you know, the millennial song.
Okay. Yeah. All right.
So if anybody's got a line on the flute player, email Tim, gettinghiptothehip.com.
There you go. Right.
You know, copy
Pete at gettinghiptothehip.com as well. On everything.
Save the Planet, I thought it was a banger. I really dug it. At first I saw that too, but then I kind of looked past the name of it and just looked at the song itself. There's two references in this album to crossing the street, to pedestrian crossings. Yes, and I'll point out the other one. This is the first one. Fucking solo bangs in this. I thought the flute at the end was cool because it was so random. I was like, whoa, yeah. What the fuck is that?
Yeah, same.
There's...
You just can't imagine listening to Road Apples and having a flute, right? Like, so it's like, it's just not part of this band, you know? Like, and it works.
It's not Ian
it works
Anderson.
So well. No.
Right.
Yeah, you know, if they went into that, I'd be like, well, what the fuck's going on?
But I'll just quickly add that I'm okay with the flute. Like, sometimes the flute really is awesome.
I think it's great.
So, you know, like, some people, like, hear the flute and they're like, oh, why? You know, but it works.
No, I dug it. And this is, again, this is not the first song or not the only song on this record where I got some heavy Alanis vibes. The phrasing on if the bathwater's clear and my ear's underwater, it's a tolerant hum from the core, carry the water. Like that, the way he phrases that shit, it's just,
yeah.
I don't know if I see, because it's a Canadian band, if I see everything through the lens of like Canadian pop artists, but like, it's just the vibe I got from this. And it's a great tune to get out and move your feet to, get running. It's a fucking cool song to run.
All right.
I'll put it on my playlist. Right.
I hear your Alanis vibes marrying up with my Michael Stipe vibes. I think those are in sync for sure. For sure.
I think there's a nice correlation between The Hip and REM. Like, I think you're right. Like, they both have that enigmatic front man, you know, who is really literate and really, interesting in the way they sort of phrase things and put things together.
They both went bald too, halfway through their careers.
That's right.
It's a fair point.
Fair point. Fair point. All right. We're getting in the car right now and we are cruising northeast of here and we're going to Bob Cajun.
And he's in love with a girl from the country. Around Bob Cajun.
I left your house this morning. It was quarter after nine. Could have been a Willie Nelson. Could have been the one. But when I left your house this morning, one star at a time. I drove back to town this morning with working on my mind. I thought of maybe leaving it behind. I went back to bed this morning, and as I
This tune. I got some heavy, and Tim, yes or yes, if I hear a no, I'm off this podcast. Got some really strong G Love special sauce vibes from this. Yes, just the way they open up. Am I right, JD? Like,
I don't know.
I think that's right. I'm very familiar. I did not go there, but I will. Okay.
Right? I mean, it could have been Willie, could have been the wine. I heard that song. The first time I heard that song, I took it out for a run and I came home and I listened to it again because I just thought it was such a good fucking song, because it's a weed reference too. May not necessarily be about them listening to Willie Nelson. It's like they were smoking weed or they were drinking wine.
Absolutely, yeah.
The opening, like, spacey guitar licks, the dobro, which I think he's playing. There's a dobro in there that he's playing, which kind of gets sort of like a banjo / guitar vibe.
I feel like that lyric that you just quoted, though, could have been the Willie Nelson, could have been the wine. That's like one, like, when he wrote that, he should have just put the book down, put on a fedora, long overcoat, grabbed his briefcase, and just went home for the day. That's totally. That's a day at the office. That's a fucking...
A day, Exactly.
That's just such a great lyric.
Exactly, dude. No, 100%. It's so good. When I heard, I was like, you know, a line is a good line when you hear it and it's so good you think you've heard it before. Meaning, oh, like, I'm like, right? I mean, because it just sounds like it belongs on this, in the history of life. Like someone has, like, if someone hadn't said it, they sure shit should have said it. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
You know, it sounds like it's a great fucking line. I thought I may be quitting. That line, it's really the part of this song where Gord starts coming out of the cage on this record. I feel like that was the moment. If somebody unlocked the door of the cage and he's starting to come out. And then the song ends on a random minor chord, which is so weird.
Yeah.
It's such a, like, a happy, spacey song that just ends on this minor chord.
I loved that. I loved that about it. So for me, this one, you know, it felt a little out of the gates. I need to listen to the beginning of it to see your G-Love reference. But out of the gates, it felt to me a little bit country and a little bit like, are we reaching again for some crossover fans along the southern belt of the U.S.? Like, what's happening here? You know, there's some slide guitar, but is it a song about lost love? You know, looking up at the stars, waiting for a reveal. You know, there's synth work in here again. Is there some sort of keyboard happening, which is fucking cool? And to me, the first listen, I had all those kind of questions going through my head. And then I thought at one moment, like, this is actually a fucking beautiful song. Like, it's a little bit of an odd man out on the album, but it's actually a beautiful song. There's this long ending with no singing. It's just mysterious. Like you said, Pete, the last 5 seconds or so, or this just bizarre tune out. It's like, I found one quote when Gord was asked about this song. He said, this was an interview in 2004. He said, this one asks the question, evil in the open or evil just below the surface? That was his comment about this song. So it's like this song to me was so super nebulous. Mysterious. Yeah, yeah. Super mysterious song, which I fucking love. Like, I don't need literal storytelling every single song. Thumbs, you know, social themes, I don't know, all these different things. I don't need that every single song. I love, you know, kind of the knuckleball that comes in. You're like, whoa, okay, this is reeling me back in to the album in a good way, a way that I'm looking for, you know, I'm hoping for.
Yeah.
So, but still, again, this one felt a little bit odd man out, just the way it fits into the album. But they've done this before. They've gotten
Fiddler's Green, man.
Yeah. They've gone on this path of like, okay, this one, now we're going to turn off the highway and head down this 2-lane road. And we're going to stop at this farm and we're going to have an afternoon barbecue with his family. And, you know, I don't know, like, it's just, this one's off the highway.
Cool. What do you guys think of the bridge? It makes my arm hair stand up. Oh, that night in Toronto with the checkerboard floors. There's a bar in Toronto that's famous, legendary, in fact, called the Horseshoe. And that references the Horseshoe, the checkerboard floors. And that's one of the first big gigs they played in Toronto.
Can I get taken to that bar when I come visit Toronto?
Absolutely, let's do it.
Sure, shit, hope so, man.
That would be cool.
That this song is actually the most listened to hip song on Spotify.
Oh wow!
Yeah, surpasses. Yeah,
I read something about that as well.
What was the one that it surpassed? I can't remember. Anyway, yeah.
Well, so it's a hit all around. Bob Cage.
Yeah, it was a fucking interesting song. You know, this is.
So we shift gears now in a, well, not in a huge way, because this is sort of low tempo or slower tempo. We go to Thompson Girl, and you're both hesitating to start. Which tells me something.
Thompson Girl.
Go ahead, Tim.
Yeah. Well, you know, what's the story about here? I don't know. It's the story potentially about where is it here? This town in Manitoba, Thompson.
Yeah.
Or it's you know, it's potentially about a nickel mining company up there. You know, it's got this kind of sweet, forlorn grunt work somewhere between dream and duty poking through with all them shoots of beauty. I mean, what is that about? You know, this is kind of a cute, in a way, stripped down acoustic song. There's some banjo in there. You know, I had been waiting for this type of stripped down, simpler song that, you know, it's kind of this forlorn, sad song to me at the same time.
How about you, Pete?
I loved it. I thought it was cool. I think, I don't know if it's consistent with you and I, Tim, but like I really try not to look too deep into the lyrics because oftentimes I'm disappointed. That's why I don't do it. I know you do it a lot more than I do.
I totally do. I mean, it's because of Gord. Like Gord for me, Gord merits it, you know.
I get intrigued though, but like, dude, so does, I mentioned Steely Dan earlier, like Donald Fagen's lyrics are notoriously cool as fuck. But if you ever ask that guy, like what he, you know, what's the meaning of, you know, Dr. Wu or whatever, like he'll be like, I don't know, man, we were on so much cocaine back in the day, I was just getting shit to rhyme or whatever, you know, like, but I know that's not really the case here, but that line, the way he goes up so high with grunt work, I'm not even gonna fucking try, lest I fucking destroy your listener base, JD, by singing that line. But when he goes grunt work, time between dream and duty, the melody is so fucking good. It's then there's a part, I don't know if it's like, I don't know, I wouldn't call it the bridge, but it is a bit of a some sort of key change to the regular chord progression when it goes really high and then the mandolin starts to come in.
Right.
Fucking right. Dug that.
Yeah.
And then the piano kind of comes in at the end as well. It's fucking cool. I really dig it.
Yeah.
I liked it. At first, I didn't like it. I didn't like the chord progression. It just seemed too, like you said, Tim, acoustic. It seemed like it was like, this should be an acoustic song. Let's keep it that way.
Yeah.
But then it grew on me real quick.
Which is maybe something I would potentially envision from a stuck in the studio couple days. You know, you'd get to a point to where everybody's kind of burned out and you pick up the acoustic and somebody sits at the piano and you talk about, is it INCO, INCO, and the fucking nickel mining? And I looked a little bit into that in Manitoba and was like, oh, geez, here's a historical, you know,
right,
just rabbit hole that I can't go down right now. But it just, this to me is just one of those songs that fits in well with this whole album, and it's something we haven't really had in the past, so it's kind of happy to hear it. Next one, Membership. Who's singing backups? Somebody found, is it Gord? Is it Gord over?
Usually it's Paul Langlois, usually.
Well, but this I might think
be,
it's Paul.
Might be doubled.
If you go in and listen again, check out Membership and listen to the backups, because it sounds like a woman to me and it sounds really familiar. Like I've heard this voice before. And I've looked and looked and looked, but I can't find anything. It might be one of the guys just, you know, editing it in post or something. I don't know, but there's some beautiful backup happening. This one, though, you know, it's wasn't my favorite on the album. I'm not going to put it on the playlist. There's kind of a big change after the 3-minute mark with like this new chorus. Of course, it has my fade out at the end. You know, there's there's kind of this bigger start to the song, but it's kind of slow in a way. I don't know. It's maybe about addiction. It's kind of a ballad. You know, this one, it just felt like it didn't really fit in. I wasn't really sure how it was working, and it made me consider, you know, I've done this a few times, that it made me consider the band and what they were feeling. You know, they're coming in on 2000 here. what they were feeling after 10 years, which is long for any band to retain some amount of success. 10 years of playing and predominantly being popular in their home country and not even gaining a huge, you know, the level they deserved in the neighboring USA. So this kind of made me think about all those things. I just didn't know if it was like about power, abuse of power, or addiction, or longing, loss. I don't know. This song was kind of all over the map for me, but ultimately the chorus bugged me and it stuck in my head for a little while. I was like, oh, I need some other hip song stuck in my head. And that's kind of where, honestly, that's where like Blow It High Dough just comes and takes over my brain. So that's what happened on Membership.
I don't have a ton to say about this song. It's kind of like I put it in the same category as Poets. It wasn't my favorite song on the record. I liked it, felt it like it was very drone rock with the chord progression, just the way it sounded. I love the harmonies. Tim mentioned the harmonies being drawn along by it, like that line with the harmonies come in. The middle guitar solo where they kind of tease you with the guitar solo helps build the song kind of cool. Mm-hmm. But then, yeah, the fade out at the end, it's just like, it felt like they maybe didn't nail everything down with this one. Yeah. That's all I'll say, you know, but yeah, we can move on if you want.
Well, let's slide over to Fireworks.
You like Fireworks? Yeah, me neither.
If there's a goal that everyone remembers, it was back in 72. I'll squeeze a stick and I'll pull the trigger. And I remember as I'm sitting beside you. You said I couldn't give a fuck about hockey. Never heard someone say that before. You held my hand, we walked on a long way. Losing in my grip, I'm Bobby Moore.
Stars shining up in heaven till there are no stars anymore. Isn't it amazing and a friend poster sky. This one thing doesn't have to go up.
Oh, how much time you got, man? Fucking song. This song, I just have the word, it's this fucking rush. Just so much rush in this song.
Really?
There's a couple of Rush references on this record, and this is number one. I would say that, is it Gord Sinclair?
Yeah.
So like, and I think he would agree with me because I don't know any bass player in Canada, let alone the entire world, would put them up against Geddy Lee. So I can't like,
true.
Like, I don't think the bass in this song was supremely Rush, but the chord progression, the structure of the song, the lyrics, isn't it amazing? Anything's accomplished is fucking. It's so
completely.
Fucking, dude, it's fucking Rush, dude,
completely.
To the fucking T. It's like they should have just made a record with one song on it and sent it to Rush and been like, "This is for you guys. We love you guys." And dude, I'm not saying anything remotely like they jocked anything. It's an homage in the sweetest sense. It's fucking beautiful. I fucking listened to the song so many times. There's, I don't know if he's playing a Les Paul or a Hamer, Rob Baker.
Yeah.
But it's got some hollow tone electric guitar. There's a line in there, Crisis in the Kremlin. I'm fucking, the words in this song are fucking spectacular. I bet it just destroyed the crowd live. Like, yeah. I mean, if they played this fucking live, you'd have to close with this or I don't know what you'd play after this. I mean, it's just fuck. What's the other line? Next year, comrades in the National Fitness Program caught in some external flexed arm hang, drop into the mat. Dude, the way he speeds up that verse and fits all those fucking words into that. And then he goes back to the normal cadence. Like when I say cadence, I mean like the tempo, not a modal cadence, but like the tempo. He goes back to that. I just bet when they all listened to this track after it was mixed or they all recorded everything, they all just fucking high-fived and hugged each other and had a big old fucking 100%. Circle jerk.
Yeah.
Because, dude, it's a fucking... It's one of my favorite fucking Hip songs, period.
Oh. You know what they said after they recorded this? They were like, this is going to be in every jukebox across Canada. I mean, this is a jukebox song. I mean, really, this is like, play something by the Tragically Hip. Okay, I'm at the jukebox sticking a quarter. Oh, here's Fireworks. Everybody loves this song. You know, that's I couldn't agree more, Pete. I just felt like this could be put on a 7-inch only and out in the world. You know, it was one of the first songs in a while where like I immediately just started snapping my fingers. It was like, okay,
dude,
this song's moving. I completely agree with the Rush references. I so identified with this girl. There was actually a girl who said she didn't give a fuck about hockey. I never heard a girl swear, and I've never heard someone say that before. It was like there was some whole other world out there, which is hard to fathom at times. I don't follow hockey. I totally identify with this. When I go on Facebook and it's like near the weekend, it's mostly fucking NFL comments from people I know in Southern California. It's like, God damn, I wish I had a sports filter on my life because I don't really follow any sports. So this hockey, this hockey comment, I was like, yes, I want to hang out with
me too. People.
Let's go drink beers. You know, I probably follow, it's whatever. I identify with that part. It's, you know, you're right, Pete. Isn't it amazing? You could do anything. When the notion isn't in your way, believing in the country of me and you, you know, it's just, it's more than an anthem, you know.
The phrasing is so, it's so Geddy Lee though, man.
For sure.
What's this? It's Spirit of the Radio.
Okay.
That's really? The song I'm thinking of. It's in so many ways. It's,
yeah.
I mean, and I don't think any musician in the band would say like they can, you know, drum like Neil Peart. I think the guitar is pretty, it's got some solid Alex Lifeson vibes. Like you could fucking compare that guitar wise, but like mm-hmm. bass and drums, you can't fucking come close to those. Mm-hmm. Other, like it's just, but sorry, Tim, I didn't mean to interrupt you, but if it's
nah,
just
it's a good,
fucking,
it's good.
It's such
a JD. What were your thoughts on this song? Do you have memories of hearing the song or anything? Or like,
I think it's a romantic song. Like, I think it's like the firework of like meeting somebody that is just, you know, absolutely, the sparkle of your eye, you know, mm-hmm. sort of thing. The context, to give you some context, the goal that he's talking about, the goal that everyone remembers, is when Canada beat the Soviets in USSR in 1972. And that was during the Cold War. So it was a big deal. That series, Canada playing hockey against Russia, you know, a few games here in Canada and a few games in Moscow. It was a big deal, like for these Canadian totally. Hockey players to go to Russia. Like at that time, Russia was so mysterious. There was a very famous goal that won the series by Paul Henderson that everyone remembers. It's one of those moments in Canada that if you're of the right age or generation, I'm not. I'm born in 74, so it's over my head. But if you were there, then it's one of those like, you know where you were moments. You know what I mean?
It's that, huge, that goal, huge moment famous? In sports history. Yeah.
So for him to be just blown away, like, you know, loosening my grip on Bobby Orr, like I just picture the 16-year-old who's in love with Bobby Orr, has the hockey cards on the wall, you know, he's just tremendous. And all of a sudden he just, oh, there's girls out there. Oh, and there's this particular girl who doesn't give a fuck about what? Like, whoa, fireworks, you know?
Yeah,
it's a fucking great song.
Great song. This, I could have had this song, you know, and had a satisfied meal and went to bed.
You and your food. All right,
baseball, JD. Come on.
We go next to Vapor Trails.
Vapor Trails. Like I started this one and paused and had to come back to it. I didn't keep going. Like this was one of the breaks in the album for me where I was like, okay, I'm not either not in it enough or not focused enough. Let's come back to it and
didn't hold
played
your
it.
Attention.
Yeah, not at the get go, but eventually it did. Eventually it did bring me in. It totally was one of those songs that I wasn't so sure about, but over time was like humming it while walking around the house. You know, there's just, to me, it has some mysticism to it. There's this mysterious, not to say it again, but backup singer, whoever is in there. I mean, there's some really good backup singing happening, but I just love some of the lyrics. There's nothing uglier than a man hitting a stride.
What a great lyric, right?
Dude.
And just the way he says it as well. There's nothing uglier than a man hitting his stride.
Yeah.
I'm so
like, I can't wait to use that some point in life, you know, watching something happen.
Yeah, Gord's good at that.
Use that line. Throw away the rudder, float away like vapor trails, you know. I get this. It's like, it's this feeling of like giving up. You know, at some point we all... Everyone, I think, everyone has contemplated, you know, life being different or serious change or giving up or, you know, we've all had these heavy times in our lives and maybe this song kind of hits on that. There's amazing guitar riffing just towards 4 minute mark. It felt... You know, just to kind of wrap it up for me, it felt like a produced ending. You know, the fade out was like, it wasn't just, let's wrap this song up, let's just fade it out. It was like, let's produce the fade out. So it was a little, I don't know, a little more orchestrated. But yeah, it's this song is the song was a banger. I think it was really good for the spot in the album. I think it was like really fitting.
Yeah, because we're well into the second side now. Second track, second side. If you're playing by those rules,
has a good place in the album.
What do you think of Vapor Trails, Pete?
Well, this is the other thing that I thought was it's not a Rush reference, but I actually think there's a possibility that Rush's 2001 record Vapor Trails was perhaps maybe an homage to Tragically Hip.
Wow.
I don't know. That's my dream world. I don't know if that's really true, but and I saw them on that tour and they were fucking just amazing. Saw them at the Irvine Meadows, man. Such a great show.
Never saw Rush. I was supposed to see Rush on a tour in 93, and guess who was opening for them?
Who?
Tragically Hip.
Jesus.
Wow. Nice.
On Road Apples. Yeah.
Dude, I don't know what's a bigger fail, that or not partying with the
hip. Oh God. That's the fail.
They're close.
Not partying, I think.
Well, let's put it this way. We showed up to that concert, I think, and we were at that time, it's strange, real quick side note, but during that time, because 2001 was coming out of the Napster years, right, and into, like, I think it was right where the iPods came out. So people started buying music online again, sort of. So bands didn't have money to pay for opening bands during that time. So a lot of bands would tour and you'd be like, who's opening? And like, there's nobody opening. So we assume that somebody was opening for Rush. Happened to me with Pavement one time, but that's another story. And we walk, we're racing through the parking lot because we hear Spirit of the Radio, but right into Red Barchetta after that, and just fucking made my life. But to the song, Vapor Trails, the fucking vocal melody in the opening verse. Same, I got the same cadence, Tim. I don't know if you mentioned this, as Thompson Girl. But the song, I loved it. I imagine when they sung this song live, that when Gord sings the line, you can throw away the rudder, he probably blows out either part of the low end or part of the mid end frequencies in the fucking speakers at this house system. His voice is just at that frequency where if he really punches it, like he could break some fucking windows. Cause it's just fucking, just the way he delivers that shit. Throw away the rudder. What else? Yeah. Just that line to me was worth buying the fucking record. Pulled the car over. There's nothing uglier. Yeah. Than a man hitting his stride.
Yeah.
There's a transition from the bridge back to the chord progression that's super abrupt. And it's so cool because there's no transition. It's just like boom, boom. They go right back into the chord progression and it's fucking cool. I can't think of any band that I've heard do that. And then the last thing is the line, and it's maybe Rob Baker. I don't know who's singing the backup, but Mexicans dressed in beige shirts. Crazy fucking line. Yeah.
Yeah, I've never heard that.
Mexicans dressed in beige shirts. It's like almost whispered.
Wow. I gotta that get the
references
better
head, get the better pickers, you know, it references folks who spend their life picking the strawberries and raspberries we eat. I believe.
Yeah, I would guess so.
I believe it does, so, yeah.
Are we going to rules?
You got it, dude.
I
take it away.
This song. I love this song. It was so fucking cool and so chill. This starts out with those huge cymbal crashes in the beginning. This is the second song on the record that references a pedestrian crossing. Talks about a crossing guard not doing their job. So, right. Yeah,
and the second really reference of Super Farmer,
right? Uh-huh.
In that same stanza, I think. Yeah, right?
Got some agricultural themes happening. Probably the third agricultural theme.
Yeah, I don't know. I just, the phrasing was beautiful. I'm wondering what a bard is. B-A-R-D.
There's a couple of references with that. One is it has to do with a Shakespeare reference.
That's what I thought, yeah.
Yeah, and then the other one is, I'm going to butcher it. The other one has to do with fighting. I'd have to look it up.
Let's just go with Shakespeare.
Yeah, it's some Shakespeare reference.
And then, dude, the line about the vacuum's got a guarantee. That line hooked me in so much because it was so random that I was like really in, just paying super close attention to what he said. And the next line that he delivers, which is, it could suck a virus, an ancient virus from the sea, is like, what the f-? Like, again, put on the hat, put on your jacket, close the briefcase. Fucking, you've done your job today. Leave the office, Gord.
That's right. Punch out or whatever, yeah.
That whole stanza is fucking amazing. There's a table slide. And then, oh, by the way, this song and, fuck, there was one other song. Goddamn. This song and one other song on the record, it's earlier. I want to say it may be Something On or Save the Planet. At the very end of it, you hear the word, somebody in the studio goes, cool.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so it does it at the end of the song. And there was one other song on the record that does it. So it was like, they did that twice. That's cool.
Pete, I'm going to need access to your premium sound system.
Well, I mean, JD, this is not stuff we just hand out. It's kind of like, you know, top secret clearance. There's a lot involved. A lot of screening.
All right. All right, all right.
He passed. He's done it.
Yeah, it's true, yes. We've driven in my car before.
He's had it, yeah. I heard this song and I thought, Pete loves this song so much. And when we come talk about it on the pod, it's going to be all Pete.
You don't have much to say?
I thought it was kind of a yawner. I got some from it, but you know, I was like, this song isn't for me. I thought it was kind of a yawner. I was going to leave it to Pete.
We're going to come back in a year because it's going to be a grower for you. I guarantee totally, you, man. This song will be a grower for you.
If it's not, you guys both have to buy me beers.
I can live with that. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Okay, well then let's slide into Chagrin Falls, Ohio.
Take it, Timbo.
Yeah, so Chagrin Falls. So this song I thought was basically a huge fuck off to corporate man, to the man. I thought this song is driving some culture into the fan base. It's probably, you know, was played a lot on the radio, I thought, this one. You know, I could be wrong, but this song to me felt like on the verge of angry a little bit more than usual. It made me really wonder about it live, if this got more raucous, if it got a little bit more, I don't know, violent feeling. And I think it's because it thematically, which is where I'm going to go, not so much with music on this one, but thematically, it Chagrin Falls, in my research, that's the headquarters of Clear Channel, which at the time, Clear Channel Corporation was slowly taking over media, in especially North America. That. Yeah, so that's a lot of the reference of Chagrin Falls, you know, where the unknown won't even go because... At this point, I mean, that line to me says, if you're an artist and you're trying to make it, like, avoid Chagrin Falls, avoid Clear Channel, you know, be careful with what radio you're sending your tapes to, your CDs to. Like, this is that song that is kind of the band's shout to the world of, you know, corporate media is taking over the airwaves. You know, be aware. So that to me, the song has like a mission. It felt like the first time I listened to it, when I got to, you know, two-thirds of the way through, I thought, is this song like over 5 minutes? You know, it felt long, but it didn't feel long in a bad way. Like, it felt like a good, just a really well written song. Like, I was kind of digging Sugar and Falls. It felt like a 5 minute song, but it's not a 5 minute song. I didn't look up live versions of it, but I definitely want to find something like
that. Yeah, get the answers to your questions. I can't unfortunately answer because I saw them on that tour and I don't remember if they played it. But
I imagine it was somewhat rare. I feel like it was probably going to be a rarely
played. Yeah, it would be one that would be, you know, gosh. Well, let me just quickly look up how many times they played it.
I mean, for people that don't know, Clear Channel took over took over FM radio over time. Like, so many stations became Clear Channel stations and became programmed. And I remember hearing the transition, because as a big radio listener, being born in 71, you know, I listened to radio for like 20 years, and they just completely took over. And I remember hearing DJ's demeanor changing from independent radio station to now being put into this box. And I feel like that's what the band is trying to talk about in this song. And I think it's their fuck you to this corporate system of being in a band and trying to make it, and just to inspire people to be independently minded. That's what I got.
Yeah, it's funny you mentioned Clear Channel, only because, and I want to talk about the song, because I feel a little bit different about the song in some ways than you do, Tim. And it's funny, like, Tim, I didn't do fucking a pubic hair of the research you did for this fucking song. I had to look up where Chagrin Falls was, but, and I dug it. But yeah, that's when there used to be a great station in, classic rock station in LA called Arrow 93, and they went over to that Jack, you know, that Jack format, Jack FM, which is just, it's just a guy who like records something and it's like a cheesy line, and he comes in every three or four songs and says something. There's no DJ. It's just,
weird.
It's just music that's, you know, topping the charts that day. And it fucking sucks. That's why radio.
Yeah,
is dead.
Yeah.
But the song itself, huge again, Alanis beginning, that fucking downbeat, the way the song starts. I thought, it's crazy you said it wasn't something they went to live a lot, because I thought this song would have fucking killed live. I think maybe because of the subject matter, they thought, oh, maybe we're being too political, people aren't going to be into it. But the fucking song is, the internal melody, there's this weird thing going on where there's these internal melodies in the song where there's like, it's not like harmonies, it's like two different melodies going on, like DNA, and it wraps up to make this fucking beautiful code that is this song. And there's a record, I don't know if it's a record scratch or he's scratching like the low E string of the guitar. Did you hear that? I mean, could have been the premium sound system in the car, which I'm willing to bet that
could've
it
been
is.
The line.
Could have been the Willie. But no, there's definitely some record scratching or some sort of scratching that goes on in the song.
I'll try to catch that.
The no profound sound, that build, and then his voice gets all fucking echoey. And then really got some Jerry Cantrell vibes from the fucking, the harmonies in there from Alice in Chains. Like, just, yeah. I don't know if that was who was doing the harmonies on that one, but super high, super cool. Fucking
again, typically it's Paul. Typically, like early on, it's Gord Sinclair, but then later on, it becomes Paul. I looked up the show that I saw. It was the one that I saw in Hamilton. It was Saturday, July 4th, 1998. They played the entirety of Phantom Power. They played 21 songs on the show. the entirety of Phantom Power. They did play Chagrin Falls.
Wow.
It was the third time they'd ever played it, and they played it a total of 127 times.
Oh, okay.
Wow. So
they played it. To put that in perspective for you, New Orleans is sinking. They played 831 times.
Oh.
Jesus
Christ. 100th Meridian, they played 756 times.
Okay.
Ahead by so a century, 693. So, yeah, definitely yeah. a rarer song.
Okay.
That's crazy.
Cool.
All right.
Do you, just real quick, do you remember hearing Chagrin Falls on the radio? Was it a radio?
No, it would not. At all? No, okay. It was not. Okay. It wasn't a single. Okay. This next track was a single, though, and that's
big
strange
time.
To me. It's strange.
Really?
To
me. Yeah, me too. Oh.
Yeah.
Same here.
5 minutes, 5 minutes, 52 seconds. That's a long ass single.
It is, but I love it. You know, this, the first time I heard, this was another one I got to, and I was like, save it for later. You know, I'm getting to this point, Pete, you talked about this, we're drinking a lot of hip Kool-Aid. You know, it's like, oh my God, I'm starting to burp here a little bit. And Escape is at the hand of the for the traveling man, and I got to it, and I thought, okay, 5 minute song, I'm at the end, let's just see what Emperor Penguin's all about. But I, of course, came back to it, and I thought, Traveling Man song. I thought this song could be like its own book.
Thank you.
single. Yeah. You know, yeah. It makes the mind travel. It makes me wonder. It made me wonder, like, what hip album are we on? You know, what song order are we in? Like, where, how does this song fit in? It even has these ambient sounds in the background, which is a little bit unusual for hip songs. Yeah. Like, there's just stuff.
Keyboards too, yeah.
Yeah, there's just stuff going on. It's about, you know, meeting, like Gord, I think somebody... Some of the research showed that Gord talked about meeting Jim Ellison from Material Issue, which I haven't listened to Material Issue yet, but really want to. And just about meeting people on the road that you know of or have read about, you know, like we all have people we're fans of. And when you actually meet that person, here you are standing in front of this person that you know fairly well. Just because there's stuff out about this person, but they don't know anything about you, or maybe they do, but it's, you know, either way, the song is like, it just reminded me of meeting artists I adore. Like, you want to hang out with them for a week, but if you get 3 minutes, it's like,
but they checked out an hour.
Totally good enough.
She chuckles. I love that.
Totally good enough. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's what else? It's about
the world building that he does. What do you think of that? Like all these bands and all these songs that this band has created. Like I want a cover band to come out, or we should do a pod list for this podcast, but you have to be one of these bands mentioned in this song. And the song that you write has to be one of the songs that like somebody That's needs cool. to write. Yeah. They checked out an hour ago.
Yeah.
Like what is that song?
Yeah. I thought overall it's kind of a heartbreaking song. It was one that I, for this album, it was one of the few that I kind of went back and dove into and went back and dove into and really dug. Like it could have, in a way, the album could have ended here for me.
Okay. Tell us.
It's good.
Yeah. I think Tim said most of it. I really like the line, it's not like we were best friends.
Yeah.
It's just fucking, it's a sad tune. It kind of kills me a little bit. You know, thinking about what this song, who this song is referring to. And like, he killed himself, correct? He committed suicide.
Right. Right. Right.
But, you know, I liked the tune. I thought it was, the wordplay was awesome. I love the keyboards in it. I kind of feel the same way as it, like this would have been a good one to end it on.
Mm-hmm.
But you know, you said most of it, Tim. I'll leave it there. Yeah. I'll leave it there.
Yeah. I love that.
You guys are killing me here. I want to hear what you love and then I'll go back to what I was going to say.
No, I was just going to kind of wrap on my end with the fact that I love how the song made me think about relationships, made me think about relationships that I have that, you know, I would love to make stronger and give more time to, but it kind of fucking doesn't matter. You know, like it reminds me of people I know that I could hang out with tomorrow or I could hang out with them in like 20 years. And it, like I said, it reminds me of meeting artists who I adore. You know, there's this club in Portland I was at, seeing some bands play, and I'm standing there in line, and the keyboardist of the band is standing in front of me, and I don't know a ton about this person, but you know, it just got to the point where it's like, what the fuck do you say to somebody who you kind of adore and you know a little bit about? And in essence, it kind of doesn't matter if you're not really going to see them again. You know, it's just the song left like this feeling of space that would continue on and you could leave it behind and come back to, which I think is pretty fucking cool. To do that in a written form of art is fucking cool.
You know, I got to give you an answer to that. Like, what do you say? Because I've been in that position too, Tim, and... Honestly, I know it sounds stupid and simple, and you know, whether it's a specific record or it's the newest record that just came out that you're seeing them on the tour with, whoever it is, just look them dead in the fucking eye and be like, I really dug this new record. Or, I really love your music, man. Just thanks for making it. And yeah. You say that shit, like, dude, it's better than any cheeky fucking thing you could think of or like plan or whatever. You'll just make their day. Cause like that's why people make music, man. Anybody who says they make music for themselves is full of fucking shit, man. Yeah, I make music for myself. I don't care if anybody hears it. Fuck you, man.
Yeah, that's funny. That's funny. You know what I did in that moment in Portland at that club? Is I had this stupid numerology app on my phone, and I opened it up, and I was like, hey, when's your birthday?
Oh.
She turns around, and she's like, you want to do some numerology thing, don't you? And I said, yeah. And so she gave me her birthday. I was like, we went into it and we fucking played around. The queue to get into the bathroom was long. And we played around on this app and laughed at each other and like pointed out personality traits that we love and hate about each other. It was fucking
funny. That is a story that turned out way different than I thought it was going to
be. Yeah, dude, it was epic. I mean, I was like a little bit high, a little bit drunk.
There, bud.
Yeah, I was like, you know, I'm not going to stand here for 5 minutes and tell this woman how much I loved her last album. I was like, we got to pass some time while we stand here doing the wee-wee dance, you know?
What's your favorite jelly? Strawberry?
My daughter and I were having this discussion this morning because she doesn't like grape jelly.
Oh,
and I was like, that's terrible. All right, we're steering clear of... what is my favorite song on the record?
Oh,
Emperor Penguin. So let's hear it, fellas. Let's hear everything that you've done wrong here.
Well, let's raise a glass of milk to the end of another album review.
Yeah. Well done,
Tim. He says to the end of the day. You know, it's funny when I heard that lyric, let's raise a glass of milk to the end of another day. It reminded me of this comedian, this bit I heard, and this guy was like, ladies, if you are ever out on a first date and you're out to dinner with some guy and he orders a glass of milk with dinner, run as fast as you can. And that's, you know, raise a glass of milk. That just reminded me that I started laughing.
Reminded me of Clockwork Orange.
Yeah, sure. You know, there was, I guess, not a whole lot to say on the song. Sorry, JD. I felt it was maybe out of the whole album, kind of the cheesiest one.
Cheesy?
Even the ending. Even the ending is like, really? Like, I just...
Welcome to Getting one. Hip to the Hip with my friend Pete, and that's it. Jesus, dude.
Next episode, JD is like, so Tim died.
No, everybody's,
you know, he's no longer.
Everybody's entitled to an opinion, even if it's wrong.
Yeah, yeah. I love the whole Emperor Penguin references, which I kind of knew. You know, this is again where the band hits on like gender equality and all things around that. If you guys don't know, Emperor Penguins, like the female lays the eggs and she dips. She's out. Like the male kind of does the work. And if she doesn't return and help sustain the nest now and then, like, everybody dies, you know. So this was metaphorically kind of fun, but at the same time I was like, all right, what's the next album we're gonna hear? That's kind of where I went with this whole album. I was like, okay, I really wonder what the next album's gonna be like.
I am so curious too now. Yeah. All right, Pete, what do you think?
Well, JD, give me the skinny, man. Lay some pipe for me real quick. Tell me what
why is it your favorite?
Why is it your favorite, please?
I don't know. I love the way it builds. I love the way it builds. I love, you know, like leading up to the chorus. Sorry to interrupt you, caller, but that's a physical impossibility. I love his phrasing. His phrasing is just magnificent in this. Don't wipe your asses with your sleeves. Your crust was just incredible. The radio was edible. The lyrics and the phrasing and the structure of them, I just think are like divine, like wonderful. And it's also a song in a key that I can sing. So I love to sing it. And I've sung it before.
Nice.
You know, nice. It's It's lovely. I love the slide on the way out. Yeah.
It's a fucking, I like the song. This song, I think his voice sounds the most raw on, like when I have the headphones on.
Yeah.
It felt like he was sitting right next to me singing this song. I was like,
all right.
Kind of gave
sparse,
chills.
Right? It's very sparse.
Very, very much so. And then your comment and your, you know, love for the phrasing, huge, huge, huge. And if you disagree with me, then fuck it. It'll be the JD and fucking Tim show next week. But Joni Mitchell vibes for the phrasing. The way he, like, listen to some Joni Mitchell, dude, and how she squeezes so much shit into some, you know, into a single measure. And that's what I got from this song.
Yeah, yeah.
I feel that. I get that. I feel that. All right.
There's a volume build that's huge in it that I love. The only issue I take with this song is that I really get the vibe that Gord Downie didn't believe in aliens, and that fucking blows. That breaks my heart. Like, it just fucking does, dude. I'm a huge, huge believer, and you know, I was like, really, man? Because I think, like, you know what? And you know what?
Oh, I picture that being like a reference to what's his name who used to do Coast to Coast?
Art Bell.
Like, I take that as a reference to like them driving on the bus in the middle of the night and like, you know, hearing that. Sorry to interrupt you, caller, but you know what I mean? Like a radio call-in show, right?
Is that another caller with a bachelor's degree? That makes sense. That makes sense because honestly, like, I think about it too, and you know, not to get all existential here, but like, I think about like, I'm a recovering Catholic. So I was raised Catholic, but I'm not practicing anymore. And I think about like, you know, maybe when you die, you get to like, you get all the answers. Maybe you go to another planet, this and that. And I'm thinking like, you know, fucking, you know, I really wish Gord Downie was fucking around today so I could see them fucking live. But since he's not, I sure as shit hope that he's somewhere with aliens and the joke's on him and he fucking realizes that they actually do exist because fucking, and hopefully you're right, JD, that that's a reference because otherwise this song just breaks my fucking heart, man. Breaks my fucking heart.
Oh, I hope your heart doesn't remain broken.
Yeah, no, we'll repair it by next week.
All right. Well, let's cruise into the last segment of the show here. The MVP song, the song that you're sticking on your playlist, is it going to be there, Tim?
I suppose it's Fireworks. I was...
You're so reticent. Oh, is that because Bob Cajun?
I mean, I was a fan of Vapor Trails. I suppose it's Fireworks, though. It's Fireworks, to me, was like, you know, perfect single. It's kind of a self-help song or a caregiving song.
Yeah, I can see that.
You know, it's just it checked a lot of boxes. I love also just, you know, kid from Southern California. I love the what the fuck hockey reference. Yeah. You know? So yeah, that was it for me.
All right. How about you, Pete?
I mean, no question, Fireworks. It just gave me everything I wanted. Every fucking thing I wanted, dude.
Oh, that's amazing.
Just so good. What a fucking song.
I think this is the first time you guys have had the same song, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. We're in sync.
Yeah.
Yeah, for sure.
Totally,
I mean, if Emperor Penguin had like real alien Area 51 references, I think Pete would have been all over that.
But. Right. All right. Had he said they actually do exist, I would have been like, sorry, Fireworks. Take a seat.
I have some other kind of facts to throw in here real quick. So,
all right.
So when these guys started out, they sold a shit ton of albums and I think made some money pretty quickly, right? And then then each album thereafter was like a million-ish records sold, which is pretty fucking cool. Like that's a good job. You know, back in the 90s, you're selling albums, you're making a buck or so a piece. Like on top of touring and doing these massive, you know, arenas across Canada or whatever, but it made me think, okay, how does the hip measure up? Maybe this is a bit for another pod. I don't know, JD, but it made me wonder, how do they kind of measure up? You know, why did they, you know, why or how, why not? Were they not killing it in the U.S.? So I looked up other Canadian bands, and one that came up was Men Without Hats. These guys had, they were like a one-hit wonder, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, we can dance if we want to, blah, blah, blah. So they sold almost a million albums globally and 500,000 in the U.S. So basically more than half of their albums they sold in the U.S., which is, I think, really interesting. The Hip, for reference, sold...
Didn't they sing around Safety Dance, too?
Safety Dance, yes. Safety Dance, yeah. That's the one. The Hip sold like 8 million-ish. 8-9 million, and about 10% of that was in the U.S. Not a whole lot. Bare Naked Ladies, conversely,
yeah,
who I've barely touched on in my life, you know.
Pardon the pun.
Yeah, about almost 10 million albums, but 7.5 to the U.S.
Yeah, that's because that of that record with One
substantial.
Week.
Substantial, yeah. Rush, yeah, 40 million.
Rush,
40 million globally, 26 million to the U.S. It's like,
yeah,
all these bands.
Bare Naked Ladies did a song called Brian Wilson.
Oh, it's just
so fucking good, dude.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh.
Arcade Fire. Okay, here's something a little more current. 3 million globally, 1 million to the U.S. Like, these stats of... globally versus how many went to the USA, they don't correlate. They're not apples to apples. They don't jive with the Hip. And I think that is, I don't know. I just think it's something to note here. Like, what the hell was it? Was it Clear Channel? I don't know. Like, what was going on? What was going on? So it's making me just still feel for the band and their lineage and their history. And you know, I think I'll stop there because I'm going to save more for our finale.
Okay, cool. Well, fellas, it's been tremendous to hang out with you in this record, live in this space for the last hour and a bit. Tremendous work as always. I look forward to listening to the next record with you. Music at Work, and we'll do that next week. You now have a week to listen to that, and we'll reconvene next week.
Let's do it.
Sounds good. See you guys.
Pick up your shit.
Thanks for listening to Getting Hip to the Hip. Please subscribe, share, rate, and review the show at gettinghiptothehip.com. Find us on Twitter and Instagram at Getting Hip Pod. And join our Facebook group at facebook.com/groups/fullyandcompletely. Questions or concerns? Email us at jd@gettinghiptothehip.com. We'd love to hear from you.
Podcasts and such.